To date, the search for extraterrestrial intelligence has largely been focused on radio signals, and to a lesser degree, laser. But with only a few exceptions, these focus on searching individual star systems. In short, these are targeted searches. You turn the radio telescope to a single star system, and you scan for a period of time to see if any interesting signals are picked up. This makes for slow progress, however, in a galaxy that has over 100 billion star systems in it, and suffers from the problem of time. You can only look for so long before moving on to the next target, which means that if a transmission is sporadic, you aren't likely to catch it when it's on. This problem is highlighted quite well by the WOW signal. There were two feed horns involved with the Big Ear telescope that picked it up in 1977. The signal was seen only by one feed horn, meaning that the signal either turned on or shut off within a very short time, or it would have been picked up by both feed horns. Oddly, this feature of that telescope also eliminates the hypothesis from a few years ago that it might have been emissions from cometary hydrogen, since a comet would not have moved out of field in the few seconds between passes. Where SETI generally does not look yet is empty space that has very few nearby stars in it. Distant stars are bad candidates because the signal strength of radio transmissions decreases with distance until anything that might be there falls into the background. Granted that it also has a lot to do with how strong the signal is emitting at the source, but fundamentally it doesn't seem likely anyone would put endless energy into a signal over a long period of time. Instead, only the strength that's needed for communications between themselves that's leaking or other uses. This limits SETI to relatively nearby star systems. Indeed, perhaps the most powerful signals we are likely to see aren't going to be communications at all. Rather, it might just be powerful radar. Some of our own most powerful signals were just that. Arecibo's radar mapping asteroids was a huge signal that would be detectable at interstellar distances, except they never repeated. Those transmissions could very well someday be someone else's WOW signal. But all of this leaves a sort of pair of elephants in the room. The first is that if you do receive a signal, can you decode it? Not likely, for many reasons. But the biggest reason is that you need to know the psychology and mind of the aliens to some extent. This is a serious disadvantage. The second is that if there are technological aliens out there emitting signals that can be detected, those signals may not be in radio at all. Rather, they may come in the form of detectable emissions from a source completely separate and by nature very high power. And you don't need to know anything about the psychology of the aliens to know what's going on. It's the engines of starships crossing the interstellar medium. To look for this, you have to look at propulsion systems we can envision based on our knowledge of known physics. This is not to say we know everything about physics, we don't. And it's entirely possible that within currently unknown physics lie other types of propulsion systems we haven't envisioned, something running on zero-point energy or the like, but unknown is unknown. You don't know what to look for since we ourselves haven't seen it before and have no knowledge of the basis on how it might work. Interestingly, there have been radio signals picked up that weren't good SETI candidates, appearing natural in broadband, but with no known source. It's possible that some phenomenon we see today and have chalked up to be nature actually might turn out to be alien signals that we simply didn't know how to recognize yet. For the propulsion systems we can envision and look for, there are possibilities. The first obviously is our current favorite, which are chemical rockets. Alternatively, there's the option of railgun launches in the future. These would be undetectable at a distance, as there is just no strong signal being given off by them to look for that could be detected from great distance. Chemical rocket aliens at our level of technology are off the detection table unless they're using radio, though you could infer rocket technology if you saw evidence of two worlds in a star system showing technosignatures like radio signals, though that would be exceedingly difficult to tease out. But there is a type of future rocket that might be contemplated, more on that a bit. Another issue is size. Your spacecraft has to be enormous. Aliens would not be able to detect a human space capsule. Other than perhaps some types of probes, interstellar travel likely requires very large spacecraft. If you want to transport a city's worth of occupants, you have to bring the city as well. As a result, interstellar craft very likely could be huge affairs built in space, no doubt accompanied by fleets of smaller craft which are too small to be detectable. But with sizes that are enormous, And to attain the speeds needed for meaningful interstellar travel, chemical rockets fall off the table. The options then become fission, fusion, antimatter, and electromagnetic sails. For the first three, there are a number of different design schemes that could be used for propulsion, but just about all of them will produce high-energy gamma rays that might be visible locally, but not in amounts enough to be detectable on an interstellar basis. You'd definitely see such a thing if you were close, and you wouldn't want to be close to one anyway. But at a distance, the gamma rays would relatively quickly reduce to background. That said, it's been floated in the past that gamma ray bursts, or at least some types of them, might have been the signatures of aliens firing up their warp drives or Alcubierre drives coming out of warp. This has fallen to the wayside as further study of gamma ray bursts point to natural astrophysical events. The prospects of X-rays and certain types of fusion-based drives are better, but only to about one light year for ships of considerable size, something on level with a large high-rise building to the size of a hollowed-out asteroid. For visible light, the prospects are better. Here an option are the photon rockets. A photon rocket operates on radiation pressure by emitting light, not unlike the exhaust from a chemical rocket. These ships would need a lot of fuel, and thus would be enormous no matter what you do. But so long as the beam was pointed towards you, you'd have a chance of seeing it. A really powerful one, for example, would be visible as a star-like point within a radius of 300 light years by the Hubble Space Telescope, but would present a spectrum drastically different from a star, and that would reveal its technological origin. But it's a good idea to point out here that any phenomenon that might represent an alien starship is going to do two characteristic things. It's going to be moving, and it's going to speed up and slow down across its journey. So if you see anything from this, say a radio signal, it's going to behave in a characteristic way, revealing its nature as a starship that would be distinct from a radio signal emitted from the surface of a planet. If by chance you saw this from a perspective of being directly behind the rocket, you'd see a star-like point that transiently goes away when the engine turns off. Oddly, such transients have been seen in astronomical photographic plates and remain unexplained. With radio that's not being intentionally transmitted, but rather emitted by a plasma star drive, it's in principle detectable from radio telescopes on Earth's surface. Another would be radio generated by a magnetic sail configuration, but at frequencies absorbed by the Earth's atmosphere, so would require space-based radio telescopes to look for. There exist plans for radio telescopes that can be deployed on the moon that might search for these in the future, because the moon offers a unique environment for radio astronomy. In short, it has a far side that never points to Earth. That means any radio telescope you deploy on the far side, such as a robotically deployed dish situated in a natural crater depression, immediately benefits from almost no interference from Earth, which is being blocked by the moon itself. Right now, SETI is hobbled because humans use the vast majority of the radio spectrum, creating hopeless amounts of interference. Certain areas of the spectrum, such as the area around the famous 1420 MHz hydrogen line of WOW signal fame, are set aside by international agreement for the astronomers. Not so much for SETI, however, but the fact that 1420 is the frequency that the hydrogen clouds of the universe emit at, which remains an area of great interest in radio astronomy. Yet huge areas of the radio spectrum are almost unsearchable because of the interference. And with satellites becoming increasingly numerous with the constellations currently being deployed, this problem will only deepen. The fix is the moon. Put a radio telescope there, and the golden age of radio astronomy will truly begin. Radio astronomy truly is a science still in its infancy, and has not yet seen much in the way of dedicated space telescopes, because, well, radio telescopes tend to be among the biggest types of telescopes that we build, but in space, they can be even bigger. So the bottom line is that only certain types of alien starships will be easily searched for, and to date, other than relatively recently started work on searching plates for transients, almost no searches of this type have ever been done. The interesting thing here, however, is that a sufficiently powerful and thus bright photon rocket in space might be visible at great distance, above and beyond what we would normally expect for radio. That said, the future of SETI will not only be radio, though those searches will probably last for centuries or more. There's still a lot of unsearched stars out there. But we'll also more robustly include optical, looking for laser pulses, but also spacecraft engine signatures. Though there is one odd thought in this. Maybe the reason that we don't see alien radio emissions readily is that the galaxy is currently simply radio quiet. There may be 5 or 6 civilizations out there emitting, but finding them may be a matter of looking for a needle in a haystack, or they may simply be too distant to pick up. But that doesn't mean that it's a permanent state of affairs. There's no way to know what radio signals made it to Earth before the advent of the radio telescope. It could well be that early humans, say 50,000 years ago, were getting bombarded as the planet was bathed in alien signals, and they have now simply stopped transmitting. Over the course of Earth's existence, 4.6 billion years, it's not unreasonable to say that it's entirely possible that while we haven't seen alien signals, Earth itself very well may have. There's actually a greater chance of that having happened than there is that Earth was directly visited by an alien civilization in the past, which is also possible. Perhaps at some point in the distant past, a photon rocket was plying the solar system. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently a little spooked by the notion that it's possible, though highly unlikely, that Earth was once receiving radio transmissions from aliens, but the moment we show up, they stopped for reasons unknown. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.